breaks the power of sin and darkness. Whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder. Who leaves us breathless in our wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Truth and justice shines like a sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing. every chain will break. His broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. So open up the gates, make way. To save is here to set the captives free. But who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is the sin of the world. lived. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you. I'll sing a volume time. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You're the God who fights for me.
You
Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Your name is light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is life forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is light that the shadows can't deny. I worship you. don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Jesus, we thank you that in you we have the victory. Lord, I thank you that you fight our battles for us. I thank you that you make a way for us when there doesn't seem to be a way. Lord, I thank you that you still do miracles today. Lord, I ask that we would put our whole trust in you, understanding that you are in control and you have a way for us to go, and all we need to do is listen to you and hold on to you and let you lead us. So help us to do that. Help us to surrender control to you this morning, Lord. Have your way in us and in this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And welcome to Grace at Home. And before we get into our Bible study in Revelation chapter 10, let's pray for our friends that haven't yet come to know Jesus. Let's pray for Chase as he's off on a mission trip. And let's pray for ourselves as we open up God's Word this morning. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for our friends, our acquaintances, our family members that haven't yet come to know you. We know that you love them more than we do. And we ask that whatever it takes, that you would bring our loved ones into your kingdom so that we could all spend eternity together. And I thank you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name. And Lord, we do lift up Chase over in Africa, and we ask that you would just anoint him, that you'd keep him safe, keep his whole team safe, and Lord, that they would be able to accomplish every single thing that you have for them to do through your Holy Spirit. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name, and we thank you for your word. We ask that as we open it up, that we would open up our hearts. You'd help us to open up our hearts to hear what your Holy Spirit desires to say to your church. And Lord, help us to receive it. Help us to put it into practice. And I thank you for all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, open up your Bibles to Revelation chapter 10. We're going to read the whole chapter. It says, "Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head. His face was like the sun, and his legs were like fiery pillars. He was holding a little scroll which lay open in his hand. He planted his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land. And he gave a loud shout like the roar of a lion. When he shouted, the voices of the seven thunders spoke. And when the seven thunders spoke, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven say, seal up what the seven thunders have said, and do not write it down. Then the angel I had seen standing on the sea and on the land raised his right hand to heaven, and he swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heavens and all that is in them, the earth and all that is in it, and the sea and all that is in it, and said, there will be no more delay. But in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished just as he announced to his servants the prophets. Then the voice that I had heard from heaven spoke to me once more. Go, take the scroll that lies open in the hand of the angel who is standing on the sea and on the land. So I went to the angel and asked him to give me the little scroll. He said to me, take it and eat it. It will turn your stomach sour, but in your mouth it will be as sweet as honey. So I took the little scroll from the angel's hand and ate it. It tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth, but when I had eaten it, my stomach turned sour. Then I was told, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, languages, and kings. And we'll stop there. So, John sees another angel with a scroll pronouncing judgment on the sea and the land. John is told not to write down what the pronouncements are, but that he is to eat the scroll. When he does, the scroll tastes sweet in his mouth, but it sickens his stomach. It's interesting because the Word of God is sweet, even when you read the judgments, but judgment will happen, and we've been seeing a lot of judgment happen in the past couple of chapters, and we're going to see a lot more, but this one act speaks to the attitude that many Christians have. You see, the scroll was sweet in the mouth because God's Word is true and sweet as honey, but judgment should always sicken the heart of a true believer. I hear people say, well, I'm really happy to see him get his. And, you know, not if you're really a true believer. God is not happy to sentence anyone to any kind of bad thing. That's why, like we talked about last time, the choice is ours. We choose to be cursed. We choose to be blessed. And hopefully we're smart enough to choose to be blessed. But when we see judgment on anybody, judgment is always sickening to the heart of the true believer. And today we're going to talk about the judgmental attitude that many believers have. The critics, the fault finders, the hypocrites. See, God's not going to enjoy exacting judgment on anyone. The true believer will not enjoy the judgment of God on anyone either. In fact, it should sicken our stomachs. So, there's judgmental Christians. God will judge, but it's not my place to judge others. I'm not God. Now, we all make judgments about what is right and what is wrong. I'm not talking about that. But when we sit and act like we're better than anybody, then we're in the wrong. Because the truth is, I'm not better than anybody. I'm not better than anybody. I'm just a guy. And I've allowed God to lead me and guide me as best as I can follow. But I'm just a guy. I don't have any real reason to put myself up here and somebody else down there. That's what being judgmental does. It puts you as the judge? Who put me as the judge of anybody? Nobody. God's too smart for that. But we do have to, you know, saying, well, you don't judge. You know, you do need to have a good sense of what is right and what is wrong. And that in itself is a judgment. But it's not putting yourself above someone else. Matthew 7, 1 and 2 says, do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Do you want somebody to use the measure that you use against you? I can think of times in my life when I certainly wouldn't want somebody coming back at me with the same measure that I was using. See, God, when He judges, He's making right judgments. We're looking from an earthly point of view. We can only see the here and now. God can see how everything we do right now affects eternity. We can't see that. We can't see the heart of the person that we're sitting in judgment over. God can. We can't. All we can see is the outward things that they're doing and saying, or not doing and not saying. But we shouldn't place ourselves above anybody else, because we're not all that. Romans 14:4. By the way, I'm reading in an old version of the NIV, the NIV 83 or 84. It's my favorite version of the Bible, and they don't make it anymore. And I wouldn't be reading to you out of this one, but my computer died. And didn't die altogether. It can still scroll up and down a Word document. So I'm using the notes that I had made earlier. I couldn't get it to work with my Bible software, so we're using this old version of the NIV. And I hope you don't mind. It's actually, to me, clearer than the others. But I don't use it anymore because nobody can get it. So Romans 14:4. Paul speaking, and he says, who are you to judge someone else's servant? See, anybody that we put ourselves in judgment over, they're God's servant. They're not my servant. To his own master, he stands or falls. And he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. See, that's the thing. When we're judging someone else, God's able to change their heart. God's able to bring them to a place of repentance. Yeah, they might be doing something wrong, but they're not a lost cause. And so often we write people off as a lost cause that God hasn't written off. Romans 14, verses 10 through 13. You then, why do you judge your brother? Or why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. So then each of us is to give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in your brother's way. See, people hear that we're Christians, and they are expecting us to tear them down. They're expecting us to be these rude, judgmental people. And unfortunately, they get that attitude because of the church. There's so many of us who are rude and judgmental. But that's not who God has us to be. God wants us to be compassionate and caring and forgiving. Now, I do know that there are times that you have to rebuke somebody. It's not fun. It's never fun for me to rebuke somebody. But it's necessary sometimes, especially when they're leading others astray. But that's a different subject for a different time. 1 Corinthians 4, verse 5, therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait till the Lord comes. That's what we're reading about right now. Wait till the Lord comes. He will bring to light what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of men's hearts. At that time, each will receive his praise from God. And believers are going to receive rewards from God that we don't really deserve because Jesus is the one who performed those good works through us. But he's going to give us rewards, and I believe that we're going to place those crowns, if you will, at his feet because they belong to him. They don't belong to me. It's nothing good that I've done. It's only God that has done good things through me from time to time. James 4:12 says there's only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor? Hi, neighbor. So why do we judge other people? Often we judge somebody else because we want to feel better about ourselves. Or we want to ignore our own problems and focus on theirs. And that's really not what we need to be doing. I need to be focusing on the work that God still needs to do in my life. And you need to be focusing on the work that God still needs to do in your life. Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. And we're so busy messing with everybody else that we completely lose the fact that God needs to do some work in our lives. How many of you would say God still needs to do some work in you? Anybody? Mm-hmm. So Jesus is talking about this very subject. Excuse me. I'm boring myself. Matthew 7, verses 3 through 5, Jesus is speaking. It says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a big plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. See, we're running around with this big old plank in our eye. And say, hey, let me help you. Oh, let me help. Ow! 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 We can't help them until we get that big plank out of our own eye because we're hurting them with that big plank that's sticking out of our eye. So we take the plank out of our eye, then we can help somebody else. And notice that ours is a big, huge plank. Theirs is just a little bitty speck. And yet we have to ride roughshod over those people because it makes us feel important somehow. James 2:13 says, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Those are strong words. I think we need to get on the mercy train as quickly as we possibly can. Romans 2, 1 through 4. You therefore, Paul speaking, have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge the other, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things. Now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. So when you, a mere man, pass judgment on them and yet do the same things, do you think you will escape God's judgment? Or do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, tolerance, and patience, not realizing that God's kindness leads you toward repentance. See, we're running around passing judgment on people, but we have a tendency to do the same thing. Oh, it might not be the very same thing, but they have their favorite sin, we have our favorite sin, and we're doing ours, they're doing theirs. How can I possibly judge somebody else who's only doing the same thing that I'm doing? And a lot of times we have a tendency, if somebody is doing something that we do, to judge them even more harshly. Because we're really kind of judging ourselves. God's judgment is based on truth. Our judgment's based on supposition. God's kindness leads us to repentance. We need to focus on being kind. We don't need to focus on winning an argument. We don't need to focus on pointing out everybody else's faults. We need to focus on being kind. Focus on being kind. And in 2022, let's let this be the year of kindness. We've seen enough hate. Let's not contribute to that. And the reason is God is gracious and compassionate and loving. He gets a bad reputation because of Christians. In John 8, verses 3 through 11, it says, the teachers of the law and Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group. And said to Jesus, teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say? They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. And I know that I've heard lots of teachings or preachings on what Jesus was writing in the dirt. So I have my theory. It doesn't say here what he was writing in the dirt. And I just find it really interesting how people can come up with doctrine out of something the Bible doesn't say. But anyway, my guess is he was playing tic-tac-toe with the apostles. And he's going, okay, Peter, come over here. I win. John, can you give me some competition, please? I win. It's just as good as anybody else's theory, right? And it says in the 7th verse, when they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, if any of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. I win. James, you want to come over? I win. And he looks up. It says in the 9th verse, at this, those who heard began to go away one at a time. The older ones first. A little bit of wisdom there, right? Until only Jesus was left with the woman still standing there. Now, what was the requirement that Jesus gave them? He who is without sin, cast the first stone. Who was the only person there who was without sin? That's right, Jesus. He was the only one who met the qualifications. So he's going to take rocks and really beat this woman up, isn't he? No. 10th verse, Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go now and leave your life of sin." What did he say? Go now and repent. Go now and repent. Change your mind about the way you're living and leave your life of sin. It's what he wants all of us to do. And when we sit there and just point our fingers at people, that doesn't bring around repentance. It just brings anger. See, we should be gracious and compassionate and loving just like Jesus. Jesus had every reason, or every right, anyway, to throw stones at this woman. But he didn't. He said, "Neither do I condemn you." Jesus had every right to throw stones at you. But he didn't. He said, "Neither do I condemn you." Jesus had every right to throw stones at me. But yet he didn't. He said, "Neither do I condemn you." That's what he says to anyone who will come to him and humble themselves before him. And we should be like him. We should be gracious. We should be compassionate. We should be loving people. Why? Because that's our family characteristic. Children of God. Ephesians 4:32 says this, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you." How many of you have been forgiven by God? Can I see your hand? No, I can't see your hand. God can. Yeah, we've been forgiven by God. So let's be forgiving people. "Oh, but you don't know what they did." No, but God does. And God knows what you did. And if God can forgive you, and if God can forgive me, then why can't we forgive others? We should be able to. And with God's help, yeah, it's going to take the help of the Holy Spirit. Because sometimes people just get on your very last nerve, don't they? Mm-hmm. It's what people are good at. But God is good at helping us show grace, mercy, compassion, love. John 13, 34 and 35, Jesus says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this will all men know that you're my disciples, if you love one another." A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. How did Jesus love us? He gave his life for us. Now, are we supposed to go around being crucified for everybody? No. But we need to lay down our ego and all that and be willing to forgive. Laying down my sense of what justice is and forgive and let somebody else off the hook. What do they owe me anyway? They're God's servant. They're not mine. So let's let God deal with whatever he needs to deal with. And let's let you and me have a clear conscience before him and be the people that he wants us to be. Let's be known for love. Let's be known for being kind and compassionate. Let's be known for that. When you read the great things that Jesus did, almost every one of them was preceded by a sentence similar to this. "And Jesus had great compassion on them," or on him, or on her. Have you noticed that in the Bible? He had compassion on these people. God loves people. God loves people. And that was really good for you and me because he loves us. Because we're people. Who knew? But we need to be looking for reasons to be kind to somebody else. And that happens most of the time when we stop thinking so much about ourselves and we do think about the benefit of someone else. Look over at 2 Peter chapter 1. We're going to read the 5th verse through the 11th. I can't read anymore. I'm going to read the 5th verse through the 9th verse. 2 Peter 1, 5 through 9. Peter speaking, and he says, "For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness." Oh, goodness. "And to goodness, knowledge. And to knowledge, self-control. And to self-control, perseverance. And to perseverance, godliness. And to godliness, brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure," not in decreasing measure, but in increasing measure. In other words, they're growing all the time in your life as you walk with Jesus. "They will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." See, these things, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, love, they keep us from being ineffective and unproductive. God wants us to produce much fruit. We have to have these things in order to produce much fruit. 9th verse, "But if anyone does not have them, he is nearsighted and blind and has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins." See, that's what I think about a lot of people that call themselves Christians. I'm not going to say they're Christian. I'm not going to say they're not Christian. That's what that's for God to know and for me to find out. But there's so many people that call themselves Christian that act like they've never done anything wrong. Peter says if anyone does not have these characteristics, he's nearsighted and blind and has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. See, he's not being gracious. He's not being kind because he's running around believing about himself that he's never, ever done anything wrong before. Now, can you say that with a clear conscience, that you've never done anything wrong? I can't. And we need to realize that everybody else running around in this world is just a human being just like we are, and they've messed up just like we have. And don't you, when you've done something wrong, don't you want the person that you've wronged, when you ask them to forgive you, don't you want them to forgive you? Yeah? Well, then we should be forgiving of other people because that's what we want other people to do for us. I don't know anybody who doesn't want to be forgiven of the things that they've done wrong, if they'll ever admit that they've done anything wrong. Have you met those people that just act like they've never done anything wrong before? There was this band. I've talked about this before, but what this guy said to me is just, I think, pretty profound. It's simple, but it's profound. We used to bring this group into Tallahassee when I was a youth pastor there, called David and the Giants. And David Huff was the leader, lead guitarist, lead singer, songwriter. And we'd had a bunch of other bands in this church. Church was kind of large and had a big budget, so I used that budget to bring Christian bands in. And a lot of the other bands that would come in would just be, you know, ungrateful and kind of, you know, kind of jerky acting, you know. I mean, not all of them, but some of them. And these guys, they came in and they were just so humble and so nice. I was upset because when they came in, we didn't have enough money to take them to someplace nice, so we took them to Shoney's. And I was embarrassed, and I was, you know, and they were just over the top appreciative of us taking them to dinner at Shoney's. And they were just going on and on and on about how great it was, how nice it was of us to take them. And I just turned to David and I said, you know, you guys are just completely different than everybody else. You're just so nice. You're so kind. And he looked at me and said, brother, we just remember where we come from. And I think that's the problem with so many Christians. They don't remember where they come from. He knew what Jesus had forgiven him of. And so he was genuinely happy when somebody was able to help them have a meal of any kind. Brother, we just remember where we come from. Colossians 3, verses 12 through 14. Therefore, and if you see the word therefore, you need to look and see what it's there for, but we don't have time to do that. So you can go back and look yourself. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion. Here's that word again, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievance you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And on top of all of these virtues, put on love. Because love binds all of those other virtues together. Don't love like the world does. See, the world loves because. I love you because. That's not the love of God. The love of God is, I love you because I love you because I love you because I choose to love you. I just love you. If we can tell somebody why we love them, then we don't really love them. Because as soon as that characteristic goes away, and through time, I'm sure it will, whatever characteristic it is, oh, I just love her hair. I love her because she just has such great hair. Well, if Evelyn said that about me, I've got a problem right now. You love me because of my hair, right? I used to have long hair, for some of you that didn't know. But no, I had a friend, Miles Monroe, who was passed away few years ago, but he always said that. He said, if someone can tell you why they love you, then they don't really love you. Because we don't want to be people who love because. We want to love people just because we love them. We choose to. In spite of all of their bad breath and body odor, we choose to love them. In spite of all their bad manners and all, you know, their cheapness and all of that stuff, we still love them. We choose to. See, God's love for you is unconditional love. And he tells us that we're to love others as he has loved us. Unconditionally. The world does a lot of things. And it's all conditional. If you do this, I'll do that. If you do this, I'll do... It's how contracts are made. See, a Christian shouldn't have to sign a contract. A Christian should be able to make any kind of deal there is to be made on a handshake. Because their word is so good that you don't need a contract. But in this world, nobody trusts anybody. So you have to sign these contracts that are conditional, and our love seems to have morphed into something that's not really love, but it's conditional. Oh, if she smells good, I'm gonna keep loving her. Well, what if she has a day where she's working out in the yard and she stinks? And I mean, Evelyn never stinks, yes. But other people do. But our love should be without condition. And that's the kind of love that the world should know us by. See, I titled this teaching, God's Judgment, Not Mine. I just need to put myself in a place to agree with God. And it says in some place later on in Revelation that we're going to be gathered around the throne saying, true and righteous are your ways, O God. In other words, right on, God, you were right. I didn't understand it at the time, but I understand it now, and you were right. We're all going to be saying that because you know why? He is right. He is true. 1 John 4, 7 and 8. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. We need to be people running around this planet, not spreading hate. And by the way, it's not hate to disagree with somebody. It's just you have a different opinion. Oh, don't be a hater. Not being a hater, just sharing my opinion. The one who does not love does not know God. Let's be those people that love unconditionally. Let's decide today that it's not our place to put ourselves above anybody else as their judge. We don't want somebody doing that to us, so let's don't do it to anybody else. Let's let God work on us instead of worrying about our neighbor. Because I'm sure you and I have plenty of things that God needs to work on that we don't really need to get to our neighbor. God will do that. And let's be merciful and kind and compassionate and loving just like God is. Unconditionally. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you loved us unconditionally and you love us unconditionally. I thank you that you forgave us of all of our sin. I pray that we would not forget where we came from, but that we would remember all the time how much you've forgiven us for. Oh, not that we should carry around condemnation, because you've forgiven us. It's gone into the sea of forgetfulness is what your word says. So I pray we could just leave that there and not have to throw judgment at somebody else because we feel guilty about ourselves. Lord, help us to just let go of that. Teach us to be kind. Teach us to be compassionate. Teach us to be merciful and forgiving. Teach us to be loving, so that the world will know that we're your disciples. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you, and I'll see you, or you'll see me, next time.